This is Unspoiled, covering The Dresden Files, Book 4, Summer Night, Chapters 16, 17, and 18. In these chapters, Harry Dresden needs to pay the fucking bills. So he takes on yet another case. Welcome to Unspoiled. I'm a rolling thunder! Welcome to the show, everyone. I'm Natasha.
I'm Rashawn.
And in these chapters of these books that Rashawn has not yet read, we get a little bit of reconciliation between Harry Dresden and the chick who threw him into a dumpster. Unexpected. When you had been thinking who was the one holding him by the neck at the end of the last episode, you theorized like pretty much everybody but her.
No, I included her.
Did you?
Yeah, I did. Because okay. Because she was one of the only women that we had met that I knew was physically able to do this.
Okay.
But I was also wide open because I was like, they're throwing so many new characters. It could just be somebody I haven't met yet.
Gotcha.
Okay. I'm going to go ahead and count this. You know,
this is a win.
I'm going to count it. I'm going to do like a miles, half a point.
Oh, I forgot that he did that. Guys, that's a reference to the Game of Thrones podcast. For those of you who don't know, the Unspoiled, patrons only Game of Thrones podcast. Forgive me. I'm adjusting my mic here because I'm too loud. So before we get started, I wanted to up top make some announcements because a lot of people don't listen to the end of the show and miss announcements. And then I get all kinds of messages from people who are like, wait, what? And I'm like, I said this shit. Don't do this. Don't do this. So I'm saying it here at the beginning so that if you miss it, that's on you. It's still on you anyway, but this will be like extra on you. So the first thing is that the day after tomorrow, Stranger Things Season 2 will be released on Netflix.
Oh, that's right.
And I am going to be binging that shit because I am going to cover the second season with Maggie.
Yay!
She will be the unspoiled one, as per last time. And she's really bad at it. Maggie being the unspoiled one is hilarious. She cannot handle it at all. And she could barely handle it last time, and we were covering 3 a week. So I don't know how she's going to do it this time, because we're not doing an accelerated format this time. Just going to be 1 a week. So she's going to, you know, have to sit on it even more than usual. But yeah, so everyone, if you haven't listened to the first season's coverage of that, you should go check that out on iTunes. And thank you to Krista for making the logo for that one also, which has the now kind of iconic Christmas lights on a wall with alphabet underneath it, background. Second announcement is that Justified will be ending forever. Season 6 is the final season, and we're going to be doing the coverage for that last episode at 7 p.m. Central Time on Saturday, November 4th. And if you guys would like to join us, we're going to be doing it live on YouTube. And I had been a little bit ready for Justified to be over by the time that I got to this season, because I just felt like there weren't that many listeners. But this final season has been so goddamn good that now I'm kind of taking that back and wish the show was going on a little bit longer. I'm not really ready for it to be over after all. So yeah, that's going to be a live event available to everybody that is not patrons only. Also, bringing Maggie back up again, I had been covering Orphan Black with Owen, but his schedule is so erratic that we just couldn't give that show the attention that it deserves, considering how complex that whole plot line is. So Maggie is going to be taking over for Owen in the new year, and we're going to be able to get back on track and do that as a weekly show. Owen and I covered the first 2.5 seasons, and Maggie is currently binging and has gotten past where he and I had covered. So now she's starting to get into territory where she's messaging me on Facebook angsty because she wants to talk to me about something and she can't. And let's see. I feel like there was another announcement. Oh, yes. And this is the other one. Rashawn and I have decided that we're going to be taking a break after we finish the Prisoner of Azkaban reread in order to cover Westworld. That is going to be in the new year. And apparently, the second season of Westworld is due to air in spring of 2018. They don't have a hard date yet. But if that works out, Rashawn and I might be able to cover it, the first season, and cover the second one in real time as it's released.
Oh, I hope so.
So that would be cool. We kind of thought that was what would happen with Leftovers, but then they pushed back the release date on the final season of Leftovers by like 2 months. So that kind of fucked up our plan. So, you know, Westworld hasn't committed to anything for dates, so they might change it. But that would be pretty cool if we could do that. And then once we come back from our Westworld break to continue with the reread for Harry Potter, the reread will be patrons only. It will not be $5 and up patrons only. It will be $1 and up patrons only. If just $1 will get you access. But I needed to make some room on my roster for other things. And I really feel like, having the first three out there for the reread is pretty fair. And, you know, I also have to do what's good for my business, because that's what this is. It's what I love, but it's also my job. So almost everything. The last thing is, Rashawn, I don't know if you saw this, actually. I posted in the patrons group that Iceland has a Christmas tradition called, I think it's Jökulbókaflóð, which means the Christmas book flood. And apparently Iceland publishes more books per capita than like any country in the world. And they have this tradition where they give books to each other as gifts on Christmas to open on Christmas Eve. And then they spend Christmas Eve eating chocolate and reading new books that they just got as gifts, which I think
amazing,
right? I think that's rad. I saw this as a little status that Krista shared, and I was like, holy shit. And I shared it in the patrons group and was like, would anybody be interested? And I got a lot of responses. So we are going to be doing a patrons only book swap for Christmas. I have it in hand with both Krista and Megan Walsh, who will be running point on a lot of this stuff. And we are going to have it be kind of a round robin thing so that you will be giving a gift to someone and receiving a gift from someone else rather than a direct exchange. And we're going to have a questionnaire to make sure that people who are international get paired with somebody that it's reasonable to ship to. And if you have, if you would like to include treats, you know, talk about food allergies. Also, of course, what kind of genres you're into, what authors you hate, what authors you love, that kind of thing, to make sure that you get something that you would actually be interested in, or just, you know, if you have a wish list and you would like something off of that. But I'm really excited about it because a lot of people seemed really into it. And I would love this to be like an ongoing tradition for Unspoiled patrons for Christmas every year. So hopefully this goes well. And if you are a patron and you are interested in that, you can either message me or you can find the post in the group. Because I made a special separate group just for that so that we can have all of the posts on that in one place. Making that my 1100th Facebook group that I have created. I have too many groups that I've made.
You do love to create a group.
I do. It's just, I like compartmentalizing stuff. It makes my brain calm down, you know? But sometimes, weirdly, trying to organize makes things more complicated.
Yeah, when you have like 87 million groups out there.
Listen, do I criticize you for not having groups? No, I don't. But yeah, I think that sounds awesome. Just like having some weird, maybe like cool Christmas treats that you've never tried, and then a book that somebody sent you, and just curling up by the Christmas tree and reading Christmas Eve. Like, how yeah. awesome is that?
I mean, I got candy today from a listener. And so right. I'm always going to be like, send candy. So, yeah.
I'm really jealous because I haven't gotten mine yet. I forgot that it was coming because she sent me a message and was like, hey, BT Dubs. She was sending from Canada.
Yeah.
So she needed my phone number for like customs or something to like send it. And I had forgotten, and I checked it, and it's like in transit. It doesn't even say like in transit arriving tomorrow. It's just like in transit. I'm like, God damn you. I want specifics. But yeah, so I'm just really excited about that whole idea. So that's all my announcements about special exciting things that are coming up, but I'm pretty excited. There's a lot of changes. And the new year is going to have some interesting stuff happening. So that will be cool. All right, so let's get into these damn chapters, shall we?
Yes, ma'am.
Harry is being held up by the neck. And as it turns out, it is the woman who threw him into a dumpster. And she is a changeling, as we find out.
I read these chapters, and the whole time I read them, all three of them, I kept saying, I had so many questions. And look at me getting all these answers.
How about that? Yeah.
Now, we had talked last time because Billy had said that they didn't smell like, I think he said they didn't smell quite human. Or they mm-hmm. smelled off or something.
They didn't smell normal. Yeah.
Normal, right? So mm-hmm. we knew that there was something going on. But I didn't know we were getting half-fay.
Yeah.
Right?
Like, and, you didn't know that was even a thing, right?
No, of course I didn't. Mm. I mean, you know, I'm learning slowly that pretty much everything can be a thing in this world.
That's true.
Because so not only are they changelings, but what does she say? Her father was a troll?
Her mother was raped by a troll.
Okay.
Yeah.
So her mother was human.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so, mm-hmm. yeah.
and her father considered it to be doing her mother a favor.
He
didn't just eat her. Yeah.
Yeah, this is horrible. But yeah, you know, but also it's a whole other layer to this world. So I was like, okay, that's like a lot of answers for like the first three pages of a new chapter.
That's true.
But then it just keeps going.
You mean the book didn't stop?
It didn't just stop. Like I was like, okay, we can stop now. The whole series is over. We found out that not only are they, well, I guess because they're changelings, they get to decide who they're going to be loyal to.
Yeah, like, they choose whether or not they want to be human or fae in the end, like who they want to be loyal to.
Right. And then once they, if they decide to be fae, then are they part of a particular court, or they get to choose which court?
I'm guessing that they have to be part of the court of the fairy that begot them.
Okay, so I got a little confused on that, which happens to me. There's always one thing each time we record where I'm just like, did I read that wrong? I read that completely wrong. But so this girl's name is Meryl, by the way, mm-hmm. which I don't know. Some reason I was like, of course it's Meryl.
Why?
I don't know. I honestly don't know. I just did.
Okay.
I was just like, yeah, Meryl, that sounds
right.
It sounds wrong enough to be right.
That is super weird. I'm not sure how to take that, but okay.
How many Meryls have you met?
Well, I've met Meryl Streep several times. So, you know, I guess it depends on how much Meryl does she count for. Does Meryl Streep count as 10 Meryls? Because I kind of feel like she should.
She counts as 100% of the Meryls because she's the only Meryl any of us ever know. But we know her so well, she's tricked us into believing it's a common name.
She's like Meryl Concentrate.
So, you know, Meryl sounds like, oh, that's a regular name. That's no big deal. But really, no, it's not a regular name at all.
It's not, no.
You only know one fucking Meryl, and that's Meryl Streep. So,
that's Owen's what I friends mean. Adopted a dog that's got, like, part poodle and has a coat that looks like a pelt. And they named the dog Meryl Sheep.
Oh, my God.
So I guess I've met two Meryls.
Okay.
Anyway.
So she is here holding Harriet by the neck, and it's very menacing, but actually she's here to apologize and ask for help.
Yeah, weird way to start apologizing. Right. Right. Let me fucking apologize.
Yeah, Harry is this is like you're doing it wrong.
And she's actually, it turns out, like, kind of, like, soft-spoken,
yeah,
too.
Yeah.
He's surprised by how gentle her voice is.
Yeah. He makes such a to-do about her appearance and how homely she is and, like, weird and stocky. Mm. But then you find out, oh, she's, like, I guess part troll?
Yeah.
So, there you go.
Yep.
And it made me feel really bad for her.
I know, especially because, like, her best bud is super, super gorgeous. Yeah. Which probably does a number on you after a while.
Yeah. And this girl, what's her fucking name?
Lily.
Is not only is she gorgeous, but she's also, like, super delicate. She can't even survive, you know.
Yeah.
On her own. So she's got this gorgeous girlfriend who's her best friend that she has to be responsible for, you know. Who mm-hmm. probably gets all the attention while Meryl's doing all the fucking work. A little bit more bitter than I had planned.
Oh, that was amazing. You really just showed your hand on that one.
But enough about me.
Oh, shit. Yeah, so, and it turns out that they were all somewhat close to Ronald Rule because he stood in between them and, was it Maeve, who was, like, torturing them?
Yes. So, that was what was, so Maeve from the Winter Court was torturing these kids mm-hmm. for fun, mm-hmm. and they were being protected by a knight of the Summer Court.
Right.
Hmm.
What?
No, I'm just trying to. I was trying to.
Trying to figure out the politics of that?
Yes. So that would make it seem like they were part of the Summer Court then.
Yeah, but, I guess that makes sense.
But I feel like it said somewhere that. I really just must have read that wrong. I could have swore that. They weren't really aligned.
The kids weren't?
Yeah.
I don't think they are yet. I think if they were, they would be of the summer. I think that makes sense, what you're assuming.
Right.
But they're. I don't think they're aligned right now. Because
She's of the Winter Court.
Which one is?
Meryl is.
Oh, okay.
So it says, she says, until she decides to be mortal or fae, she's under the rule of the court of her father, which is right, what you said. But then she says that's Winter.
Okay.
So she's under the rule of the Winter Court, but she's being tortured by the Winter Queen and protected by a Summer Knight.
How about that?
What?
So it wasn't Maeve, it was Mab that was torturing her. I couldn't remember. Yeah, that changes things because Maeve.
No. No, it says, blah, blah, blah. Wait, wait, wait. Maeve was furious. Maeve told him to back. Maeve had been torturing us for fun.
Okay, it was Maeve. That's what I thought. Because you said the Winter Queen, and it was the Winter Lady that was
torturing
him.
My fault. Mab is the queen. Maeve is the lady?
Correct.
Okay. Maeve is a lot going on.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus Christ, and we're only on page 4 of this chapter. All right, I'll try not to bog us down too much of the details. But as we get further on, the details start to really fucking matter.
Yeah.
And there's just a lot happening. And all these alliances are shifting and they're not who I think they should be. You know what I mean?
That's the thing, I think. And if you get that kind of in mind sooner than I did, things might turn out to be less of a shock for you than they were for me. But in my reading, I really expected there to be more rules when it comes right down to it,
right,
regarding who was allowed to do what in what court.
Right.
And it turns out it's a whole lot more open-ended in some areas than I really ever expected.
Right.
And there are certainly restrictions and things that are just not done. Like, not only is it a rule, but you get the impression that it's probably impossible for Winter and Summer to have interactions in certain ways because it would just throw things out of balance.
Mm-hmm.
But I thought that would apply to practically everything, and it doesn't. So, you know.
Yeah. I think, I'm getting the feeling that there are a lot of rules and regulations and formalities and bureaucracy. And it does seem like those things exist.
Mm-hmm.
But like you just said, there's a lot of wiggle room and workarounds that I just don't know exist yet.
Yeah.
You know? So when I hear that they're from the Winter Court, but they're being tortured in the Winter Court, but somebody from the Summer Court is protecting them, and that feels like, well, how are they letting that happen? But, you know.
Yep.
But it's been happening. And now he's gone, and they are basically, Harry says, like, to the wolves. You know, if he doesn't help mm-hmm. them, he's basically leaving them to the wolves.
Yeah. So this is part of the reason why Lily having disappeared is so worrisome to Meryl, because, you know, she was being particularly targeted by Lloyd Slate, the Winter Knight.
Oh, he's gross now.
Mm-hmm.
I remember, like, when they described him, remember, I was like, okay.
Yeah.
But now, no. Not okay.
Yeah. You know. I didn't want to ruin it for you at the time because you don't find this out until later, but Lloyd Slate is not good people. Which we do find out later that it's potentially Mab choosing not good people, like, on the outset. But that's kind of up for interpretation, I guess. So she asks Harry to help her find Lily. And he basically is like, I just can't right now. Like, your cause is very worthy. I hope that she's okay. But I have a lot on my plate. And I cannot add another thing to this. And then she's like, I will pay triple your fee. Here's money up front. And he's like, fine.
He's like, if I don't die, I will kind of need to pay my light bill.
Right. What a position to be in. He can be a drama queen, but he's not even being dramatic here. So yeah, he finally agrees to help her out. And I love that she's like, here's money up front. I'll pay triple what you're asking, but
I don't have the money to pay you right now.
You know, details. I'm good for it.
I love that right. so much. I love that.
We're just going to go with that, yeah. I guess.
It might take me a while, but I'll do it.
Listen, lady.
Poor Harry.
And he's like honestly so just worried about making it out of this that he, when she says that, he's just like, oh, we'll worry about that later.
Yep, yep.
Can't even do that right now. So they make this deal. Harry goes back to his car. And who should be there waiting in the dark in his car but Elaine, and soaked in blood.
Just been wondering where she was.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what's going on with Elaine? How are things working out for her? They are not
super.
They're
well.
Not working out for her at all.
And by the time we're done with these two chapters, we don't know what the fuck even happened.
No, we don't even know if she's okay. I mean, we're told that she'll be okay, but we don't mm-hmm. see her recovered.
Yeah.
So yeah, she's in his car. She's a fucking mess. She's got like lashes up and down her arms mm-hmm. that I don't even know what she was fighting. It seems almost like it was an animal or something, you know, mm-hmm. the way her injuries are described. She's fucked up.
Yeah, she is.
Yeah, kids. I don't want to mince words, but. And because people in Harry's life can't be normal, you know, he wants to take her to the hospital and she's like, no.
Mm-hmm.
Where we have to go is the summer court.
Yeah. Yeah. He there's a couple reasons why she doesn't want to go to the hospital. Mostly it's because the White Council could find her there.
Is that who she's worried about?
I think so.
Yeah. Cause she says, you know, it's too dangerous. They'll find me. But she doesn't say who. I thought she just meant whoever fucked her up. I didn't even think of the White Council.
That could be true, too. The concern that Harry tends to have, and I don't know if this was a factor for her at all, but when he gets, like, it's suggested that he should go to the hospital, his magic fucks up electronics, and he can turn off people's life support and shit. So that's a big thing for him not wanting to go get looked at professionally. So I don't know if that's part of it for her.
It's funny that you mention that because he doesn't seem to worry about that for her. He's like, immediately, I want to take you to the hospital. So I don't.
Yeah.
But you're right. I mean, Harry says that effect he has on electronics is common for wizards. It's not like it's just him. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah.
It would make sense that that's something that would happen with Elaine, too. And he doesn't seem to even consider that.
Well, and that kind of works for Harry's character as well, because we know for himself, if he knows, like, he's the only one in danger, he's willing to put up with a lot in order to keep other people safe.
That's true.
But if it's somebody else who's in danger, he's going to be like, well, we'll take the risk just to make sure she's okay.
Yeah, that's true. So, yeah, if somebody he cares about, because he's potentially risking other people in order to get Elaine looked at. But she is important enough to him. That he's kind of like, fuck those other people.
little bit. So she tells him that the summer court is at this hotel. And he walks in with Elaine, like, bloody over one arm, like, trying to figure out where he should go. And this woman gets out of the elevator, this tiny little blonde woman, and sees him and is like, oh, shit. And helps him get upstairs. And they get off the elevator. And he steps out into this, like, fairyland. And I mean that in the most literal sense.
Can we talk really quickly about how when he pulls up to the hotel, to the back entrance, fucking Elodie flies out. I forgot she was still around. Did she?
She was in his hair. Oh. I forgot about that.
I laughed so fucking hard when I read that. It seems like Harry was just a surprise. And like she pops out. She leads him to where he needs to be. And then once that happens, she leaves. She's bounced. And she's like, okay, my work here is done. Which is funny because it implies that somehow she knew she wasn't done taking him where he needed to go for the night.
That's true. Yeah, that's true.
But, you know, how, I don't even know. I mean, the idea that later on when he's talking to the summer lady and she goes into this whole weird mind fuck about how you can't trust him because it could all be a plot and everything, you know, I was like, well, is that why Elodie was still in his hair? Like, did they know Harry was going to end up having to bring Elaine here? But,
did they?
You know, I mean, I don't know, but I just thought it was really funny that she was still in his hair.
Yeah, I like the idea that she was, like, really irritated. She stayed in his hair when he was being held up by the throat because she wasn't about to pop out right then. And just bided her time. And then he's getting in the car and there's blood. And she's like, well, shit, I can't just leave now. And then finally he gets out and he's like, I don't know where to go. And she's like, ah, I'll show you where to go, but I am fucking done now. So the first reaction that he gets to arriving in the summerland, kind of, is there is a huge centaur who is not super impressed that an emissary of the Winter Court dares show his face here.
They say, it's like he stinks of the Winter Court. They're all like, oh, we can just tell. Mm-hmm. You know, it shows. I think somebody says it shows, which I don't even know what the fuck that means. Mm-hmm. But so you're right. This centaur, how funny is it that we're reading about centaurs again? And they're once again unpleasant.
Oh, they are, huh? They don't have a good rap. Even in, like, C.S. Lewis books, the centaurs, I wanted them to be, like, adorable when I was younger. And they are written as being, like, kind of prickly and proud. And I remember being kind of disappointed in that as a kid. Because I was like, but I want to ride on a centaur's back. And if they're like that, they won't let me.
Yeah, I know we talked about it when we were doing Harry Potter. And I think some listeners reminded us about the mythology around them. But I guess that's part of the deal with them is that they're very haughty and, you know, proud and kind of look down on humans a little bit. Mm-hmm. They all got a bad attitude.
Yeah, they do. You know, like, guys, I mean, you're cool and all, but you're still part horse. And that's kind of lame.
I mean, you're part horse and part mad. Man, but, you know, you don't have to be mad all the time about it.
this centaur finally gets, like, told off by one of the other gentlemen to, like, go mind his business, basically. And he argues for a second and then finally is like, oh, fine.
Yeah, this guy pulls, like, a... Like, I don't even know if they argue. He just kind of steps in front of the centaur and Harry and, like, stares the guy down. And Quirk is like, all right.
Yeah. I'm leaving, but not because you told me. Yeah, so he leaves the two of them, and Harry goes, and he thinks at this point that he's still waiting on the Winter Lady and is getting agitated that nobody seems to be taking Elaine's condition as seriously as he is.
The guy Tallows, who is the Grand Lord Marshal. All these fucking titles, guys.
I know. I promise that they aren't that important. Okay. Like,
good.
You don't have to remember them.
So he says that he can help a little bit, but, you know, it's not really the lady of the court needs to be here. But he says, you know, you can't. She'll get here when she gets here is basically what he says.
Mm-hmm.
Harry is getting so fucking frustrated. There is no sense of urgency while this woman is, like, bleeding to death.
Yep. Yeah, he, like, introduces himself all fucking, like, casually. And Harry's like, Oh, nice to meet you. Now do you think you could help me save this woman's life? Like, he is irritable. And this other lady, she keeps on with this little charade that she's just some lady with a bunch of clay.
Right. Yeah. I'm just...
And finally, Harry puts it together. Oh, my God. You're the summer lady. And she's like, what?
Mom? Yeah, he's super annoyed because it feels like a fucking cheap, like, stupid game while, you know, Elaine is kind of dying over there in the corner. And he just kind of goes off on her a little bit.
Yep. So what did you think of her?
Well, you know, Aurora. She was, like, really all sweetness and light. But I didn't really buy it.
Why is
that? Because it's that thing, right, where I think I feel like we talked about this, where the idea is that, you know, winter is always evil, you know, and summer is always good. But that's really basic and superficial, you know. Right. And everything that you've told me and that I've read so far about the Fae in general is I don't particularly believe that any of them are good in the sense that we would think good is. Right?
Okay.
So all this psychobabble that she pulls on him, you know, and all, you get in touch with your emotions and all that kind of stuff, feels just like a different way of manipulating someone.
Okay.
But she was super nice about it. You know, she wasn't like cutting and cruel the way we've seen Mab be. She wasn't as a fucking petulant as Maeve was, you know.
Oh my God. Nobody right? is petulant as Maeve.
So this was... It was nice, but it wasn't really good.
So if you think, because you use the word manipulate, what if she were manipulating him, what would she be trying to get out of
him? Well, I don't really know what anybody wants from Harry still.
That's fair.
But she says, you know, she doesn't trust him. She thinks he could possibly be an agent, whether it's witting or unwitting, of the Winter Court. Mm-hmm. So she could be trying to see... She makes this whole big thing about how much repressed rage and anger and how bad he is, really, you know. She lists, like, all the bad shit he's done. And then the capper is, and you've killed people. And then she's like, let me help you with all that. But that's a lot of where his power comes from, too. You know.
That's true.
And I don't know if she knows that. Right? But you know... But if that's where a lot of his power comes from and all that shit is gone, that kind of weakens him. I'm sure he could find other ways to be powerful. But all this to say, guys, I don't trust her.
Okay. Right on. Well, I am never going to say that it's a bad idea to reserve trust on pretty much anyone in these books. So, she does that thing where she's like, let me help get rid of some of the pain for you so that you can feel better. And he does feel better. And she's like, she had said when he first realizes who she really is, what leads him to realize is that she's like, it's a shame that someone that seems as decent as you is working for Winter. And that's when he's like, hold on a second, and realizes. And here, after she's like kind of tried to take some of his pain, she's like, you don't have to keep doing this. Like, you could stay here and heal. Yep. And that might be way better for you and maybe other people also for you to like take care of yourself a little bit more. But of course, that is not happening because Harry doesn't rest. Right. That's not a thing that he enjoys.
And I wonder, would it be better for other people? Like, if he doesn't...
Yeah, I mean...
You think so?
That's good. No, well, I was saying, yeah, that's a fair question. Like, you know,
if
like,
he doesn't, if he stays there and he gets off the case, right, that's good for the summer court, maybe in the short term. It's bad for Harry because then the White Council doesn't, you know, get what they want. There's a, then it's a whole thing with the Red Court. I feel like that ends up being bad for a lot of people if Harry doesn't finish what he is doing right now, even if I don't understand all the reasons why he's doing it.
Okay.
Yeah, I feel like it was a trap. Just stay here. And she made a big deal about letting him eat and drink and not like regular mortal food because they were not going to trap him to stay there. Right. But then she's all like, why don't you stay?
Yeah, it's, you know, obviously different if he makes the choice course, to do it. But it's certainly the same overtones of like, manipulation.
And as you wonder if there is something that prevents them from having tried. I mean, once she gave her word that she wouldn't, you know, give him the fairy food to trap him, then she has to honor that, right? Because they can't lie. Mm-hmm. But is there a reason why they couldn't have given him that anyway? Like, I'm wondering if because he's bound to the Winter Court, are they not allowed to trick or trap him into staying? Is that a magic thing?
I'm not sure.
Because them offering to give him regular food, right? Or we were not going to, you know, try to coerce you or poison you or whatever. Also makes them sound like they're really nice, you know, and better and good. But if...
So she's like not all fairies.
Yeah, trying to get like,
trying to get some cookies for like being a decent being.
And it's like you're pretending that you're pretending to not trap him out of like integrity, but really you couldn't have done it even if you wanted to, because it violates some rule that I just don't know about yet.
Right.
I don't know.
Okay. I got you. Basically just, you know, manipulating everything she can to make herself look like the side that he should
believe. like we look at us over here compared to those terrible people over there. And they do look much better. I mean, they're painting and sculpting and shit. You know, they got like a rooftop rainforest action going on. It's much better than like the fucking sewer 40s party that was going on.
Oh my God.
In the other one.
Yeah, and speaking of the sculpting, she is sculpting a bust of Lily. Right. Because as it turns out, Lily is like a model that comes up frequently for them. And when Dresden looks around, there's a ton of different statues of her all over the place in different poses and stuff.
So not only were they being protected by the summer night, but they were welcome in the summer court. Or at least Lily was.
Yeah, I'm like, because I don't know exactly how that works with like traveling between courts, but I think you're free to go no matter what court you belong to. I think you can go in and out if you want. It's just that they don't, because for them it's not comfortable.
Listen,
usually.
The way Corey yelled at Harry, called Winterbound, like there was a curse.
That's true, but at the moment things are much more strained.
That's true,
and than they normally are.
And Harry is not well liked. Period. So
true enough. Yes,
and
that's
he's
true.
In carrying like a half dead woman covered in blood, so he's not making a good impression. You're right.
But yeah, I think that like if you're in of the winter court, you can go to summer. But like, why would you want to? Right. And also, if you're a changeling, you're not as bound, so you can kind of do what you want until you are bound, if you decide to be at all.
Gotcha.
I think.
Well, yeah. That, I mean, like, yeah, if times weren't as tense, then you're right. Why wouldn't you be free to go wherever you wanted, kind of in the never never as a whole, you know? But as things get more heated and people take sides, then there's less. Well, then it's like more like America.
Yeah, right. Trenchant.
Commentary.
So this basically this encounter ends with him not really like knowing much more than when he
Yep.
left. Aurora doesn't know Lily very well other than as a model, and that's pretty much the only time that she sees her. So the fact that Aurora hasn't seen her in a while isn't unusual. And other than that, that's kind of it. He leaves Elaine in her care with the assurance that
Yeah.
she will be fine,
Right.
probably.
We find out that Aurora is planning an assault on the Winter Court by
Right.
what is it? Is it Midsummer?
Yes.
So now we have another fucking deadline.
'Cause that is when she is in her full power.
Yeah. And she feels like it's going to be like a last shot because without the night, their summer night, they're already weaker. So if they're going to do anything, they got to do it then.
Yeah, and like he's asking, well, what could it be? Like, why would somebody want to kill Rule in the first place? And she's like, well, what is it that he had that they wanted? And he puts it together that he Rule as the winter or as the summer night had a mantle of power bestowed upon him that is now gone. So, boom. So yeah, that has weakened her significantly. So she has to strike while she can, while she's at the peak of her strength, because her own like power as Summer has been depleted. So that's a pretty big deal,
Yeah.
Summer's power being taken. So yeah, just another day, another fairy fight. So Harry leaves there finally, and he makes a decision that I think everybody who reads these books cheered
Yes.
when he made.
Yes, I was about it was about fucking time. It
Yep.
was about time. I was so happy that they didn't drag it out anymore because I kind of thought this thing with Karen was going to go four, five, six books. I really
Okay.
did. With her just being on the periphery and always begging for more information, but Harry has to protect her from everything, you know. Because that's kind of usually what happens, especially if you're talking about a female. If you're talking about a woman
Right.
who is mortal or not in magic or anything like that, and the protagonist is the one who has all the power, that female character stays just on the outside forever, it seems like. So I was super happy. Harry just said, "We have to talk." And then she said,
So where they wind up talking,
Listen.
what'd you think of this?
Was actually pretty brilliant.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it turns out that the only place that's like got some people, but not too many people, and is open at this hour of the night is a Walmart
Yep,
supercenter.
and it is, you know, no lies. That is exactly what is open that
Yep.
has that meets that criteria is a fucking Walmart Supercenter.
And they sit down and they're like having coffee. I don't know what kind of supercenter they've got because it doesn't sound like the kind I
You don't
have.
have that?
We don't have a sitting area in
Are
ours.
you sure? I've never
I
been in one that
think I'm
I've never been
sure.
in one that didn't have one.
No, we don't have, like, we had for a little while a Subway in the front of the store, and then they closed and they just boarded that shit up. They didn't like take the tables and use that as a sitting area separately or anything.
There's usually like when we in both of ours that are closest to us, as soon as you walk in the door, there's like the customer service center where you do your returns, and then there's like janky kind of counter fast food, hot dogs and pretzels and Slurpees and, you know.
Okay, so kind of like what they have at Target where you buy the like popcorn and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, we do not have that at ours.
Get it together, Denison.
Actually, that's not like, because I've been to several, and I don't think more than one of them had that when I went.
Really?
Huh. Yeah, so maybe that's like a city thing?
Yeah, it could be regional, I guess. I thought Walmarts were pretty cookie cutter, but...
But in any case, they sit down to have some coffee, and she asks him if he wants to talk about it, and he's like, yes, yes, I do.
Thank you for asking.
And he just spills his guts to her about everything.
Everything. Everything. I was so happy. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of it was just like a big, you know, information dump for Karen. A lot of it was shit we already knew. But it was really, what's the word? It was satisfying.
Yes.
It was very satisfying to get this moment.
And it's satisfying for Harry because she has the same reaction that he hoped she would have in regards to the White Council when she's just like those arrogant assholes. And he just has this little like thrill of triumph that she's so firmly on his side. And yeah, this is just like you said, it's just it feels like a huge step for the two of them. Like earlier, the conversation that they had about losing their first loves and him opening up to her about that. Mm-hmm. And then this, they really like got closer. And I feel like the trust between them has deepened a lot.
Yes.
And it's just really nice to see, you know, just.
Yeah. It feels, you know, like a partnership, mm-hmm. you know, like they're on not equal footing, but even footing, you know, right. like she is no longer in the dark about so much of the stuff that she's been involved with. And he gave her a choice. He was very clear, like. Right. The stuff I'm about to tell you is serious business and is going to change your life and it's going to be dangerous. Mm-hmm. But if you're willing, if you want in, here it is.
Right.
And
he treated her like a goddamn adult.
You know, he treated her exactly. He treated her like a fucking adult who could make decisions for herself about how much she was willing to risk, you know. Mm-hmm. And I don't think I realized how rarely we get that.
Yeah.
And it's
true.
It's doubly surprising because this is coming from a writer who you and I have chided many times about his incessant descriptions of women and how buxom they are and alluring they are, you know.
Yep.
So, all right, Jim Butcher.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what I feel comfortable criticizing Butcher for his descriptions, like his constant describing of women's bodies, because I feel like he is somebody who gets it a lot more than many writers do. And I know he could do better.
Right.
So I kind of hold him to a standard that I feel like he could reach. Because in many respects, he does things that I feel like are all too rare, like this. So, yeah, I, you know, it's just overdue and I'm happy about it.
Yeah. Agreed.
So they're in the middle of this conversation, like just kind of trying to piece together from the information that he shared with her.
Yeah.
What the hell the deal is.
One of the best things that he does after he brings her up to speed is he defers to her. He's mm-hmm. like, I'm investigating a homicide and you're better at it than I am.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, goddamn.
Right? Yeah, I feel like that's something that I wish. I mean, again, I understand the position that he's in and that it's not going to be super, easy to just bring somebody into this world. But I really wish in some ways that this had occurred to him sooner, because she was just such an untapped resource, you know?
Right.
But yeah, she says, also like brings up, why would somebody try to take you out in the park yesterday? And he says, well, you know, it could have been anybody. It wasn't a brilliant attempt. And she's like, well, it wasn't neat, but it also wasn't stupid. And it turns out there have been 2 armed robberies in the past 3 days. First outside of Cleveland and then at a gas station just this side of Indianapolis. In both cases, someone was grabbed at the scene and abducted. And both times the video security broke down just as the robbery started. Eyewitnesses identified the perpetrator as a woman.
Mm.
So they figure that this woman is the ghoul and she's abducting people to chow down. 40 or 50 pounds of meat a day.
Good Lord.
Right? That's crazy.
I thought of when I read that there was a, and I know you don't really watch Supernatural, but I know Krista does.
And all right.
They had a ghoul, and it was like a flesh eating monster, and it would like peel the, you know, like peel the flesh off and just eat people. And that's the first thing I thought of, and I was just like, but even that wasn't like, I don't remember being 40 or 50 fucking pounds.
Yeah. But, I feel like, isn't there something like that? I feel like I'm going to spoil something.
Yeah, I thought that too. Don't say it because
you know what I'm talking about, right? Okay. I wasn't sure if that had happened yet or not.
It hasn't.
Yeah, that one got to me though.
Yeah, that was what popped in my head in the middle of my Supernatural description. That's why I faltered there for a minute, because I was like, oh wait, no, I can't use that second example. So never mind.
Something similar happened 3 times in connection with the operations of a contract killer who calls herself the Tigress. A friend of the FBI told me they suspect her of a number of killings in the New Orleans area, and the Interpol thinks she's pulled jobs in Europe and Africa, too. So she gets around. And let's see. Maybe they figure if your investigation finds Rule's killer and gets the council brownie points with the fairies, they're in for a real fight. Killing you before that happens makes sense. So, but then he's like, but that when that went down, I wasn't even involved in the investigation yet. The thing with the all of the wizards getting killed in Russia. It was Russia, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. So... And Harry also says, like, and also, if you even found this woman, I wouldn't recognize her because she was so nondescript.
Yeah.
She just isn't really memorable in any way.
He says she was in makeup, and by the time he looked at her again, she looked like something out of a Japanese horror cartoon.
Mm-hmm.
Which, good gracious.
Right? And then she's like, How sure are you about Maeve and that she didn't do this? And he's like, pretty sure. She's like, but not 100%. And then he says, well, Mab never out and out denied responsibility for Rule's death, but I don't think she's the killer. And she says, what makes you say that? And he's like, I don't know. And she's like, I could tell you, you're good at your job. And she wouldn't have come to somebody who was good at their job to investigate a murder if she was the murderer. Which is a nice vote of confidence.
Yeah, that felt like, you know, Harry was like, yeah, I didn't want to be the one to say it, but
a little bit, yeah. So then he says, all right, well, I need to go talk to 3 more fairies though. And the ladies are the closest to the mortal world. But the queens and mothers live in fairy proper, and he's going to really like have to get somebody to take him there, because that's not something that he can easily do.
And then he lets slip that he has to go see his fairy godmother, and I feel like Murphy is like, she has taken in all this information, but this is too much.
Right there, she's like, I'm gonna stop you. back up a tiny bit. Hold on.
But before they could even get into it, some shit starts to happen.
Yeah, it does. So all the lights go out, which, you know, and then battery powered emergency lights came up and revealed a roiling cloud of silver gray mist spreading into the store from the doors. The mist rolled over a startled cashier, and the woman slumped, her mouth slightly open and her eyes unfocused, staring. So that doesn't sound great.
It does not sound good at all. And, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of things that can go wrong late at night at a Walmart. This is not one of the things I would have expected to go wrong.
Oh, that's a pretty good sentence there, lady. There's a lot of things that could go wrong at a Walmart.
So yeah, I have no idea what the fuck this is. I really don't. I don't know. I don't think I've seen any magic like this before. If I have, I don't remember. It sounds like poison gas, but I know it's more, you know, it's not that. Or if it is, it's the magical version of poison gas, you know.
Why do you say it's magical?
Because it's the Dresden file. I'm just making wild assumptions. I mean, it's possible, you know, SWAT is outside and, you know, some real shit's happening.
You don't know.
I don't.
Listen, but, I'm just saying, keep an open mind.
But Harry feels like he knows. Because he grabs some salt, so he knows. When he gets up, he grabs the, you know, though, in this world, I feel like grabbing salt is probably almost a reflex.
You got, like, that's just smart.
Yeah.
Right? Just to have salt on you is probably a good idea.
Yeah, so maybe he doesn't know. That might just be, like, some Boy Scout training. You know what I mean?
Oh, my God.
So, yeah, I don't know what this, I don't know who was outside, who was coming. If they're coming to the Walmart right now, you know they're coming for Harry. It is not some other shit. Somebody is coming for Harry.
Yeah, you know, that's probably a safe guess. I'm not thinking that there's like a fairy like capital located in the produce section or something. Secret.
And at this point, it could be, I mean, shit, it could still be vampires. I mean, they're out there.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. We haven't seen them in a bit.
You know, it could be, we know that the Merlin, oh my God. That's still so funny. We know that the Merlin is not happy with Harry. I don't know if he would make such a bold attempt. Like, this seems pretty conspicuous for, you know, someone in his position. But he's still out there in the world wanting Harry to not succeed.
That's true.
I don't know if I think any of either fairy court would be doing it.
I'm just picturing, like, Morgan prowling around pouring water on dry ice and, like, setting a fan up. Like, he's setting Harry up to do some dumb shit in public.
He was
my last resort.
He was hanging out in Home Goods, just waiting for the right moment.
Yep. He's got his dry ice stored in this adorable rooster-shaped cookie jar that he spotted for only $5.99. Weirdly, it was in the clothing section, but you know. those fucking stores. Yeah, so that's the end of the chapter.
Yep.
That's it.
That's it.
And what do you think's going to happen, huh? What do you think?
I just told you what I thought.
What do you think, huh? Huh? You love it?
I gave you what I had. I have, yeah, I'm really curious to see what is behind. I mean, I don't think anybody will be looking for Karen. So if they're there, they got to be looking for Harry.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know, guys. We'll see. I got nothing.
Dun, dun, dun.
Dun, 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 indeed.
All right, so just want to say hi to new patrons and then we will wrap up. So this week, well, it's actually 2 weeks worth now because we missed last week. Sorry guys, I got bit by a dog. Rashawn had already like kind of been like, maybe I want to take tonight off.
Oh yeah.
And then I got bit by a dog. And so I wound up having to spend the evening in the emergency room getting stitches, which I had never had stitches before, and they are the worst and I hate them. Don't care for it. I side with Molly Weasley on this one. It sounds like you're sewing your skin together, but I'm sure it's not that stupid. What do you mean that's the basic idea? I mean, yeah, this is such a, like, the fact that we still do this, that we still sew flesh together with fucking string.
Yeah.
Isn't that crazy to think about?
It's 2017, and that's what we're doing still.
Yep.
Or our big improvement was just glue your skin back together.
Yeah, that was the other one. Oh, stick some glue on it, which they definitely did for me when I was working at Whole Foods and sliced the tip of my finger, and it did not work at all. That shit just kept bleeding. Yeah, and Owen was like in the emergency room with me for moral support, and at one point I saw him like, because I like almost hit the ceiling when they administered the needle to numb me up so that they could do the stitches, and I like screamed a little bit, and Owen looked up and I saw him like turn a color and look back down at his phone. And then later on he was like, yeah, I wish I hadn't looked up because there was so much blood. He was like, it was really gruesome. Oh, but I was like, ooh, lovely. When you look at my like the actual wounds now, they're super small. Like, it's really not. But apparently the dog hit an artery on the back of my leg. And so the doctor kept trying to be, like, weirdly cheery about it and was, like, calling to the nurse going, Grace, could you lend me your fingers? This gosh darn thing won't stop bleeding. Jeez. Hold it. Now, see? It just, you see it? It just keeps on. Goodness. And he kept talking about it like that. I was just like, please don't use this like upbeat, right? Bright
I need
voice
you to
when you're
say,
talking
God
about
damn it. The situation warrants a goddamn it.
He's trying to keep me calm, and it's having the opposite effect. I'm like, why aren't you being
the seriousness of the situation?
And then when I sat up after they finished, there was this like puddle of blood on the table, and I was just like, I had not been ready for it when I sat up. And the nurse, when I swung my legs down to just sit up, and she goes, shift down a little bit because there's a pretty big wet spot here. You don't want to sit in that. And I was like, oh. And then I moved over and finally got, like, set up. And I looked and I was like, oh, okay. This is real gross. But, yeah. Anyway, so that's my story that made whoever doesn't like blood pass out while they were listening. Sorry, guys. Content warning. Blood. But, yeah. So we missed last week. Long story short. So new patrons. Kathleen Mann. Ciro Brasil. Emma Senner. Jackie Gunn, Stacy Thomas, Kimberly Jones, Zachary Auerbach, Steven, and I. Welcome to all of you. Thank you so much for being patrons. A few of you signed up at $10 and up mark, which is awesome because you're going to be getting a patrons-only postcard. And a few of you signed up for $5 and up, which means you will get access to the Twin Peaks episodes that I'm doing with Maggie. And some of you are $3 and up, and you get a monthly cocktail hour, which is super fun, and I just did mine last weekend. And some of you are $1 and up, and you get all of the legacy episodes. Excuse me, I totally, like, hiccuped in the middle of that sentence. And, you know, access to fun stuff like a Christmas book swap. So, it's all good. No matter what you pledge, you get all kinds of great shit. It's a pretty good deal, right?
Right.
Right. Chime in there, Rashawn, huh?
I've chimed in.
Yeah. No, it's good. Is it good?
It's very good. It's very,
so...
very good.
She's, wow. Convincing. So, everyone, if you would like to become a patron, go to patreon.com/unspoiled. You can go to facebook.com/unspoiledpod, Twitter @unspoiledshow, or Instagram.com/unspoiledpod. Unspoiled Podcast to find us on our various social mediums. And I'm going to carve a pumpkin, and it's going to have my logo on it, I'm hoping, this weekend. I'm going to try and get it to do. That sentence worked, right?
if you took it apart and rearranged it, yes. Yes, it would work.
I kind of lost track of my own thoughts like midway through it. I was like, well, you know, get close enough. So thank you everyone again for joining us and listening. Please leave reviews on iTunes if you haven't already and support the show that way. And we will see you next week with a new episode. Toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys.
Was an Unspoiled Network podcast.